Recorded Books presents Wild Minds, The Artists and Rivalries That Inspired the Golden Age of Animation by Reid Mitenbuler. Narrated by Kevin R. Free. Prologue. Make Us Another. Otto Mesmer was eager for fame, for riches, for his big break. At night, he could look into the sky above West Hoboken, New Jersey, and see the glow from Manhattan's lights, barely 2 miles east and yet a world away. He was a struggling young newspaper cartoonist, only 23 years old, on the verge of joining that more dazzling world across the Hudson River. This was in 1915, when the newspaper business was still healthy, at the peak of its clout and reach. Talented artists working within its system were rewarded handsomely. At the New York Journal, a star cartoonist like Winsor McCay made more than $50,000 a year in syndication, a sum that afforded him multiple homes, chauffeur-driven sedans, and the kind of bold wardrobe choices you don't often find in the closets of people with less eccentric careers. It was a grand lifestyle, and one just starting to come within Mesmer's grasp. His work was occasionally published in the New York World and sometimes featured in Punch, Life, and Judge, the most prestigious humor magazines of the day. But there was a problem. These sporadic freelance appearances didn't yet provide a stable living. Dry spells could mean washing his laundry in a bucket of cold water or having to order the smellier cuts of meat from the butcher. Success seemed close, but he still needed a steady job. One day, in search of additional work, Mesmer packed a portfolio of drawings under his arm and headed to Fort Lee, New Jersey, several miles to the north. In the earliest years of the movie business, before people realized that Hollywood had better light and cheaper taxes, Fort Lee was a leading center of the film industry. Visitors there might catch a glimpse of glamorous stars like Lionel Barrymore posing for photographers, the wind dancing in his hair, or perhaps D.W. Griffith standing next to his camera, shouting into a bullhorn. Mesmer hoped to show his portfolio of drawings to the studios and get a job painting background sets for the movies. Mesmer presented his work at Universal, then just an upstart studio. Among his sample drawings was a flip book featuring a short cartoon about the war then happening in Europe. At this point, animation was still very new. Some argued that it could blossom into a great art form, while others said it would never be more than a novelty. The debate was still up in the air. A few movie studios, including Universal, thought animated cartoons had entertainment potential, that they could be used as a kind of hors d'oeuvre before main features. When Mesmer presented his little flipbook, the hiring man paused. "Look, don't you know they're starting animation?" he asked. "You look like you could fit in that." Mesmer was excited, but also worried. He had included the flipbook only to make his portfolio look thicker. He had no real understanding of how animation was done on a larger scale, nor did he know whom to ask. It was still a new and mysterious craft. The few people doing it guarded their methods as secrets, the same as magicians with their tricks. Mesmer told the hiring man he was interested, but admitted he had no idea what he was doing. The hiring man just shrugged. "Go ahead and see what you can do." Mesmer figured out the basics and made a 1-minute test cartoon entitled Motor Matt, about a reckless driver who fixes a flat tire by blowing a smoke ring with his cigar and using it as a spare. To Mesmer's mind, this was what cartoons should be. Wild and fantastic, immune to the logic of physics or reality. Animation could magically bring to life worlds and ideas that live action couldn't. When other Universal executives saw the cartoon, they gave Mesmer a humble space where he could work on his ideas. It wasn't even a proper office, just a rickety desk wedged into an open area between two film sets. Since movies were still silent in those days, the space was noisy from directors on different projects shouting over each other, competing to be heard. Amid this ruckus, Mesmer set to work drawing, trying to keep his pen from being jostled by crew members squeezing by. A few feet from his desk sat a caged lion, which the studio staff explained was used for jungle pictures and kept starved so he would emote more. Mesmer, whose work often involved metaphors, no doubt wondered if this was some sort of omen. Universal fired Mesmer shortly after hiring him, not because he wasn't talented, but because it was easier to just buy animated cartoons from outside studios that specialized in them. Mesmer thus began floating among jobs at the handful of new animation studios trying to figure out the craft and become profitable. Before any of his animation gigs was able to take off, Mesmer was drafted to fight in World War I. He headed to Europe in 1917, dressed in his green wool army uniform, keeping a diary of experiences that he no doubt hoped to someday use in his art. The diary's early pages, full of beautifully looping penmanship and clever doodles, described a pleasant ocean voyage to France, and then a march through a lush countryside of green hills and thatched roof cottages. As the journey progressed, however, the diary's tone darkened. Mesmer began noticing artillery hidden among the wildflowers. He could hear the roar of battle off in the distance and whiff the dry, sulfury smell of the guns. Once he joined the fighting, his penmanship grew thick and clumsy with descriptions of the war's horrors. A friend's pink brains splattered in the mud, the dying gasps of men's last words. Atrocities were all around, but he sometimes found relief in the little things, like the moments when buried artifacts from medieval French cities would suddenly appear in the trenches, surfacing in the mud like lost treasure floating up from the seafloor. It was a moment like this that perhaps inspired Mesmer to jot in his diary a possible scenario for some future cartoon. Fearless Freddy digs for gold, digs up all kinds of things from the earth. By the time Mesmer returned home in 1919, animation had grown as an industry. It was beginning to offer a viable way to make a living, although some thought it was still just a novelty. Cartoons hadn't yet ignited the public's imagination, and no cartoon character had captured people's attention in the same way as real-life celebrities like Charlie Chaplin or Mary Pickford. Mesmer resumed work in an animation studio run by Pat Sullivan, a convicted felon who had recently been released from prison. Sullivan was a rotten boss, but allowed Mesmer to work for other studios on his own time, so long as Sullivan made money from any deals. In this way, Mesmer one day ended up at famous Players Lasky, the studio later known as Paramount, pitching an idea to an executive named John King. King leaned back in his chair as Mesmer loaded the projector with a cartoon titled Feline Follies, featuring a black cat that would eventually be named Felix. Translated from Latin, the name loosely meant good luck, an ironic way to name a black cat. The film began with Felix being kicked out onto the street by his owner because he had failed to protect the house from mice. Distressed and worried about his fate, Felix wanders to the home of his girlfriend, Miss Kitty White, and begs her for a place to stay. It's not a request Miss Kitty White seems excited about as she introduces him to a litter of neglected kittens and tells him he's the father. Facing down this vision of a life shackled to domestic drudgery, Felix responds by rushing off to the local gasworks, putting a hose in his mouth, and committing suicide. Once the cartoon finished, the end of the film reel flapped loudly in the projector. Mesmer leaned over to switch it off and then glanced at King to get his reaction. It's easy to imagine a film executive from a later generation becoming uncomfortable with the film's subject matter, but this was a younger America, when people had higher tolerance and perhaps even a taste for this kind of darker material. Back then, the movie industry still existed on the untamed fringe of society and had a higher risk tolerance. King could not have predicted that Felix would soon become one of the most recognizable icons in the world, or that animation would ever become anything more than just a novelty. When he finally stopped laughing at the cartoon, he turned to Mesmer with a demand. Make us another. The origin story of Felix the Cat will be a surprising revelation to most. This and other early cartoon characters were often subversive and decidedly adult, not qualities usually associated with animation now. Many people today assume that cartoons have always primarily been children's entertainment. However, this reputation, that there is something inherently juvenile about animation, is relatively new. It began in the 1950s when the studios stopped making animated shorts for theatrical release and cartoons moved to television. The natural habitat of cartoons was no longer in dark movie theaters where profits were generated by admission tickets. It was now in living rooms, on television, where squeamish corporate advertisers had influence over what was presented. Those advertisers were also starting to notice how the post-war baby boom had created an enormous new audience of young people, and that their parents had plenty of disposable income. Once these new factors were understood, animation changed almost overnight. Before, it was something created by artists who saw themselves in the sophisticated mold of artists like Charlie Chaplin or Buster Keaton. After, it became a way to sell sugary breakfast cereal to kids. While recent history has seen a revival of some cartoons that echo the older sensibilities, glimpsed in the occasional feature or in television shows like The Simpsons, South Park, or BoJack Horseman, the art form still carries a reputation from when it was disrupted. This book is about animation's origins and rise, the first 50 years, wild decades spanning the early 20th century to the 1960s. The cartoons created then were often little hand grenades of social and political satire, bawdy yet clever, thoughtful even if they were rude. Some Betty Boop cartoons contained brief glimpses of nudity. Popeye cartoons were often loaded with sly messages about the injustices of unchecked capitalism. The teaming of animators with jazz musicians like Cab Calloway was, in the 1920s and 30s, just as subversive as hip-hop would be in the 1980s and 90s. The old Warner Brothers cartoons, Bugs Bunny, Daffy Duck, and more, occasionally offered some of the most perceptive social commentary of their era. Much of this color was censored when these old cartoons were repackaged for new formats and audiences, particularly television and young children. Much of their original spirit was reimagined, if not forgotten. The people who made classic cartoons offer a treasure trove of colorful backstories. These wild minds occupied the same zip codes as stand-up comics like Lenny Bruce, Joan Rivers, Richard Pryor, or Dave Chappelle in years to come. Like much great art, their work could be controversial. Much of it upsets the sensibilities of later generations, fancying themselves as sensitive and enlightened. Understood in the proper context, however, classic cartoons reveal much about the past, its people, and American culture. During its first half century, animation was an important part of culture wars about free speech, censorship, the appropriate boundaries of humor, and the influence of art and media on society. During World War II, it played a large role in propaganda and popular culture. Later on, it would demonstrate how the medium affects the message. This book is a narrative history of the personalities behind animation's first half century, when the art was experimental, subversive, spooky, sometimes dangerous, and often hilarious. This is the tale of an older age and a younger nation, collapsed to the scale of a curious industry, the promise and ambition, fortunes made and lost, a rise and then the fall. It is also about art and how creative people work, how their art was shaped by its time, and how that art affected the future. Chapter 1. Slumberland. In 1911, newspaper cartoonist Winsor McCay confidently declared himself to be the first man in the world to make animated cartoons. Perhaps he made his claim because he was unaware of the others, or maybe he just meant that he was the first to do it his way. Ultimately, it didn't matter. Once the words were uttered, controversy erupted and other cartoonists came forward, indignantly declaring their own right to the title. In truth, McCay wasn't technically the first. Multiple people had come up with similar concepts around the same time, but he was the most famous and admired of all the contenders. Thus, to him went the credit and the glory. Ever since McCay was a boy, people spoke of him the way they spoke of legends. His family claimed he drew his first picture before he said his first word, while people from his hometown shared similar apocryphal stories about his unique artistic gifts. The effect of these stories was to provide a sense of clarity about the vast scope of his talent, and to imbue Winsor with a sense of destiny. McCay was already famous when he created his first animated cartoon in 1911. By that time, he had revolutionized the newspaper comic strip into something resembling movie storyboards of the future. The illusion of motion, creative perspective, people frozen in action poses. His strips were filled with epic stories, capturing the public's imagination and making Winsor one of the most widely recognized newspaper cartoonists in the country. Despite these achievements, McCay was restless, wanting to expand his art further. He was drawn to the new technology behind motion pictures, then a burgeoning art form, and couldn't stop talking to his newspaper colleagues about the movie's potential. Soon, he began dreaming of making his comic strips move in a similar way. He would animate only a handful of cartoons during his lifetime, but they were wildly influential, inspiring many other cartoonists, early greats such as Max Fleischer, Otto Mesmer, and Walt Disney, to do something similar. His influence was profound, but Winsor McCay's impact on animation was all but forgotten by the time of his death in 1934. Some two decades later, his name would fade from public memory, even though many of his protégés, such as Walt Disney, would become famous. Disney was generous about celebrating those who had inspired him, however, and decided to produce, in 1955, a short television segment about McCay. Before it aired, Disney invited McCay's son, Robert, himself now gray at the temples, to come visit his studio in Burbank, California. After a private tour of the grounds, full of sunshine and swaying palms, the two men eventually found themselves standing in Disney's office, gazing out the window. Warm and casual, Walt gave credit where it was due. "Bob," he said, sweeping his hand across the gorgeous view of his empire, "all this should have been your father's." Winsor McCay earned his first money from art in the late 1880s by drawing portraits of people at Sackett and Wiggins's Wonderland, a dime museum located in Detroit, Michigan. He lived in nearby Ypsilanti and was attending classes at Cleary's Business College, where his parents had sent him to learn practical skills such as typewriting, shorthand, and simple accounting. But Winsor bristled at the prospect of a life involving practical skills and played hooky so he could go draw portraits instead. He dropped out of school shortly thereafter. Decades later, memories of Wonderland would resurface in McCay's animation. The museum was a warren of velvet curtains, red brick, and flickering gas lamps. Dwarfs and bearded ladies roamed the hallways while tattooed men announced upcoming shows. Professor Matthews' Circus of Performing Goats, or Billy Wells, the man with the iron skull who allows stone and boards to be broken on his head. Wonderland taught Winsor a practical lesson he would use later in his career. Always please your audience. "A great many women and girls had me draw their pictures, and even at that age I was wise enough to make all of them beautiful, whether they were entitled to it or not," Winsor said. I used to leave that place with my pockets bulging with money. Young and restless, McKay left Ypsilanti and, after a short stint in Chicago, landed in Cincinnati in 1891. Those who knew him said this was where he found his true voice as an artist. His heart was always with the Queen City, his son Robert recalled. The town still possessed some of its glory from the old riverboat days, picturesque yet gritty, an optimistic place that also had an interesting dark side. Party bosses, rigged elections, poker games ending with an angry gambler flipping the table over. In Cincinnati, McKay once again found himself working in a shabby dime museum, Cole and Middleton's. His office was a dingy room on the top floor, where he could look down and see pickpockets lurking around the ticket window. It was there that he designed posters for the museum's various shows. Transient and permanent curiosities without number, read one that also boasted freaks, fun, and frolic from foreign lands for fiction's fancy. The shows often featured performers like the midget Jenny Quigley, whose alias was the Scottish Queen, or Anna Mills, known by most as the girl with the prodigious feet. The poster for Wild Man of Afghanistan, another popular attraction, billed its star, rather long-windedly, as a good-natured and harmless colored giant who pushed a handcart down in the West End, but when chained up and eating raw meat and growling maniacally, he was a fearsome-looking object and drove sleep away from the cots of many boys and grown-ups, too. McKay left the Dime Museum in 1896, after Charles J. Christie, editor of Cincinnati's Commercial Tribune, noticed his work. Using the punchy language of an emphatic newspaper editor, Christie made McKay an offer to come work for him. The same money you're getting at the Dime Museum, and I'll make a newspaper man out of you. The best goddamned newspaper cartoonist in the country, that's what I'll make of you. Where can I hang my coat? McKay replied. Many great artists had started their careers working for newspapers. Winslow Homer, William Glackens, and John French Sloan had all done stints as artist reporters, drawing depictions of recent news events. The pictures were reasonably accurate, but like all great artists, these men knew that stretching the facts here and there could sometimes illustrate a larger truth. It was a lesson that was also understood by the first generation of animators, many of whom had also started their careers working for newspapers, drawing cartoons and comic strips while honing their senses of humor and satire. While at the Tribune, McKay began submitting cartoons to the leading humor magazines of his day, Life, Puck, and Judge, where his art broadened into sharper commentary. When the United States began fighting in the Philippines in 1899, he published a cartoon of a pistol-packing Uncle Sam in a carnival game, flinging doll-sized U.S. soldiers at a Filipino's head and asking, "Is the game worth the candle?" The cartoon was exquisitely drawn, as were all his drawings, and editors at other publications took note. Life, Puck, and Judge were the magazines they read to find new talent. In 1900, Winsor took a job with the Cincinnati Inquirer, rival to the Tribune, after it offered him a higher salary. His work there took on a new dimension, more surreal and full of playful fancy. In 1903, he began publishing a comic strip entitled The Tales of the Jungle Imps by Felix Fiddle, a spoof of both Charles Darwin and Rudyard Kipling. In each installment, various jungle animals sought relief from the torment they constantly endured at the hands of three semi-naked black children known as the imps. After consulting with Dr. Monk and his team of wise monkeys, the animals would then be endowed with some new physical feature they could use to defeat their aggressors. Each episode's plot was hinted at in its title: how the alligator got his big mouth, or how the quilly pig got his quills. Even though the strip's title mentioned a character named Felix Fiddle, he rarely had much to do with anything, making appearances as a bearded old man who just stands off to the side, watching all the action while clutching a cane and briefcase. In 1903, McKay received a letter from the New York Herald, which was interested in hiring him. It was a big move, off to a much larger city and market. "What do you think I ought to do?" he asked his boss at the Inquirer.
"Wire 'em and tell 'em if they'll send you a check for traveling expenses, you'll take their offer," his boss said.
With that, McKay and his family took a train east, the small towns drifting by their window, until the skyscrapers of New York eventually appeared on the horizon. In the era before television and radio, newspapers were the main form of mass communication, and their cartoon sections were especially popular. Because a well-liked cartoon could help greatly increase a paper's circulation, top newspaper cartoonists found themselves part of a well-paid media elite. Winsor McCay's starting salary at the New York Herald was $60 a week, at a time when the average American made $9. Newspaper moguls of the day, including William Randolph Hearst, Joseph Pulitzer, and James Gordon Bennett, Jr., regularly launched bidding wars for good cartoonists, driving their salaries into the stratosphere. By the time Hearst hired McKay away from Bennett's Herald in 1911, Winsor was making $50,000 a year, a princely sum. He could afford chauffeured cars, multiple homes with dark wood paneling, and custom suits in brave colors like white and fawn. The same year that McKay started at the New York Herald, he made his first animated cartoon, not because he needed extra money, but because he was seeking an artistic challenge. It all began one day while McKay was sitting at his desk, listening to his colleagues joke about how prolific an artist he was. It was a reputation Winsor was proud of. He liked telling people about how he had once received a box of chalk for his 5th birthday and used it to leave drawings all over his hometown like some sort of doodling Johnny Appleseed. "I drew on fences, blackboards in school, old scraps of paper, slates, sides of barns," he recalled. "I just couldn't stop." The habit lasted into his adult years, and now his colleagues were teasing him for it. As McKay liked to tell the story, this is when his good friend George McManus, creator of the comic strip Bringing Up Father, also known as Jiggs and Maggie, challenged Winsor to churn out several thousand drawings, photograph them quickly in sequence, and then show the result in theaters as a moving picture. McKay accepted the challenge and decided to animate characters from his own popular comic strip, Little Nemo in Slumberland, which he had created for his former employer but still held the rights to. The strip had first appeared in 1905, 6 years after Sigmund Freud published The Interpretation of Dreams, which had helped launch a popular obsession with the psychology of the subconscious. Once people read the book, they couldn't stop talking about their dreams and the notion that ideas and feelings might exist in a realm somewhere between magic and reality. McKay explored similar territory in his comic strip, playing with the familiar tropes of dreamscapes, falling through space, drowning, moving slowly while everything else around you moves quickly. Each week, his characters floated around outer space on milkweed seeds, on beds that acted as flying carpets, or in ivory coaches pulled by cream-colored rabbits. These fantasies were always rudely interrupted by reality, falling off the flying bed and waking up in a real bed, or being jolted awake by a voice telling you it was all just a dream. Adults enjoyed Little Nemo in Slumberland because it helped them reconnect to their childhood minds. For youngsters, it was a bridge to their blossoming adult minds. The strip was so popular it was adapted for the stage in 1908, costing more than any other production of its era, nearly $300,000, and featured the biggest names known in theater. The production was a critical success and popular with audiences, but made little profit because of its extravagant cost. Little Nemo in Slumberland was a highly personal cartoon for McKay. He claimed the title character was based on his young son, Robert, even though the name Nemo in Latin technically means no one. The character also demonstrated qualities Winsor had as a boy growing up in Spring Lake, Michigan, a logging town where literacy didn't extend much past McGuffey's third reader,
and most people hadn't understood McKay's dream of drawing as a career. It was a place where someone like Winsor, small, pale, destined to go bald early, inevitably adopted introverted hobbies like drawing. Just as young Winsor had done, little Nemo attempted to escape the real world by hiding in his dreams. The tools McKay used to animate his cartoon were simple. Stacks of rice paper, a bottle of Higgins India ink, a stack of Gillette No. 290 pens, and some art gum. Puffing his way through endless cigarettes, a machine belching out exhaust, he set to the task of producing 4,000 drawings, all a little different from each other. In one, he would establish a pose. In the next, he would move it ever so slightly. Flipping through the drawings quickly gave the suggestion of movement. Each drawing was assigned a serial number and was given marks to keep it in register with the other drawings. Then the drawings were photographed, with the marks kept in careful position to ensure the final image didn't vibrate on the screen. McKay was known for drawing so efficiently, his colleagues joked, that he could draw a picture in a single line without ever raising his hand from the paper. As he worked, a cigarette always dangled from his lips, the thin plumes of smoke pooling underneath his wide-brimmed hats. 15 years earlier, McKay had seen his first movie while working at the Dime Museum in Cincinnati. The film had been part of Thomas Edison's Vitascope project, when cinema was still very much a novelty. The premise was simple. Just a train moving toward the camera. But it frightened those who had never seen a moving film before. During the showing, one man stood up, screaming his head off, while another man fainted and crumpled to the ground. In subsequent years, people became comfortable with seeing photographs move on screen, but they still had never seen drawings like McKay's move in a similar way. On April 12, 1911, McKay showed his animated cartoon at New York's Colonial Theater, a vaudeville house that seated nearly 1,300 people. The spectators sat mesmerized, asking each other excitedly if it was all some sort of trick using special photography as they watched characters, Impy, Nemo, and Dr. Flip, float in space. No wires visible. As Nemo appeared out of fragments of stray lines that had coalesced to form him. When the cartoon reached its end, just a few minutes after it started, a green dragon named Bosco lumbered into the frame holding a chair in his mouth to carry all the characters away. Moving Picture World called the cartoon an admirable piece of work and claimed that it should be popular everywhere. What the magazine didn't know, because animation was still brand new, was that McKay's film had set a very high bar. Only people looking back from many years in the future could appreciate just how high that bar was. In the 1960s, an animator named Bob Kurtz would call McKay's work 70 or 80 years ahead of its time, as if he had really been born in 2025, acquired a complete knowledge of animation, then took a time capsule back to 1911 and faked it. In 1985, Chuck Jones, who helped create many of the iconic Warner Brothers cartoon characters, would say, "It is as though the first creature to emerge from the primeval slime was Albert Einstein, and the second was an amoeba, because after McKay's animation, it took his followers nearly 20 years to figure out how he did it." After finishing his first cartoon, McKay began dreaming of animation's vast potential and championing it as a new art form. Perhaps it would even replace great styles of art that had come before, he told anyone who would listen. Take, for instance, that wonderful painting which everyone is familiar with, entitled The Angelus, he announced to a crowd of fans one day, referring to a popular oil painting by the French master Jean-François Millet. Of two peasants standing in a field, solemnly praying over a meager harvest of potatoes. There will be a time when people will gaze at it and ask why the objects remain rigid and stiff. They will demand action. And to meet this demand, the artists of that time will look to motion picture people for help and the artists working hand in hand with science will evolve a new school of art that will revolutionize the entire field. Chapter 2. Phantasmagorie. Winsor McCay didn't come up with his ideas in a vacuum, and they weren't the result of a sudden epiphany. For centuries, people had been fascinated with the idea of animation, of making drawings appear to move. McCay's achievements were just the next breakthrough in a long series. In prehistoric times, people probably waved flickering torches in front of cave drawings to make them appear to move. By the time of China's Tang Dynasty, 618 to 907, shadow puppets, cut from buffalo hide and moved around behind a screen, were a common way to tell popular stories of the day. Centuries later, shadow puppets became popular in Europe as well. By this point, people were using mathematics coupled with new lens technologies to study light and motion. In 1645, the Jesuit scholar Athanasius Kircher published Ars Magna Lucis et Umbri, The Great Art of Light and Shadow. In the last chapter, he mentioned a lantern containing a candle and a curved mirror that, if manipulated in the right way, could make cutout shapes appear to move. This wasn't technically animation, but it was exciting. So exciting, in fact, that some called it witchcraft. Kircher, who had always wanted to be a missionary and didn't appreciate the witchcraft accusations, reassured everyone by using his device to show Bible scenes. Once everyone was calmed down, the path was then clear for other entrepreneurs to use Kircher's techniques for something more important, making money. A Dutchman named Peter van Musabroek quickly improved upon Kircher's lantern by fitting it with a disc containing sequential images that, when turned, made the images appear to move in a more sophisticated manner. Then a Frenchman, Abbé Guyot, compiled this and the growing number of other animation techniques in his book, Rational Recreations, in which the principles of numbers and natural philosophy are clearly and copiously elucidated by a series of easy, entertaining, interesting experiments. Insofar as lantern showmen could remember the title, this was the book they couldn't stop talking about. Magical theater shows took off like a dance craze. One lantern showman stood out from all the others, a Frenchman named Étienne Gaspard Robert of Liège. In the 1790s, he developed a spooky show, Phantasmagorie, which quickly grew famous. By 1794, at the height of the French Revolution, his crowds were so big that he had to move his show to the ruins of a large old monastery in Paris. Audiences filed into the darkened crypts, dim candlelight reflecting off piles of neatly stacked bones, to gaze at flickering portraits of fallen heroes from the recent fighting. A grand finale featured the Grim Reaper floating through the air, reminding everyone of the fate that awaits us all. In 1824, Peter Marc Roget, who would later become famous for his thesaurus, published The Persistence of Vision with Regard to Moving Objects. It described how the human eye will blend a series of sequential images into motion if the images are shown fast enough. 2 years later, John Ayrton Paris built on this idea by inventing a toy called a thaumatrope, consisting of a string threaded through a disc with a different image on each side, say a bird on one side and a cage on the other. When spun, the images seemed to combine, making it appear that, in this example, the bird was in the cage. A dispute then arose over who invented the thaumatrope. The contenders included Paris himself, Charles Babbage, Dr. William Fitton, Sir John Herschel, and Dr. William Wollaston. But the argument faded as thaumatropes were replaced by phantoscopes. These featured a greater number of discs and shutter-like slits allowing for more sophisticated movement. In 1834, the Englishman William Horner invented what he called the Dedalum, or Wheel of the Devil, which didn't become popular until the 1860s after it was renamed the Zoetrope, or Wheel of Life, which sounded more pleasant. The zoetrope was a hollow drum with slits on the sides where paper was fed in. Images were printed on the paper, and when the drum was turned, the images appeared to move. By 1868, flip books were popular. These contained sequential images that appeared to move when the pages were flipped quickly. They were given as gifts and promotions, like one that was entitled Turkish Trophies and given out with cigarettes. The cover billed it as an instruction manual for deep breathing exercises, but the naughty images inside showed pornography instead. In 1877, the Frenchman Charles-Émile Renault invented the praxinoscope, a device similar to the zoetrope except that it used mirrors instead of slits on the side of a moving drum. In practice, it worked much like the old lantern shows. Renault called his lantern plays pantomime lumineuse and enjoyed subject matter depicting the wild and surreal, such as one show portraying a black boy juggling his own head. These shows were quite popular, seen by an estimated 500,000 people between 1892 and 1900. By the dawn of the 20th century, many artists were experimenting with new cameras that recorded motion. Thomas Edison was experimenting with what he called a mutoscope, a mechanical flip book where sequential photographs were attached to a ring outfitted with a crank. Winsor McCay used a mutoscope to check the movement of his Little Nemo in Slumberland cartoon. Edison was also experimenting with the kinetograph, a kind of motion picture peep show that viewers could watch through a small pane of glass. Eventually, some of the old ideas were combined with the new motion picture technology. In 1906, an American cartoonist named James Stewart Blackton created a short film entitled Humorous Phases of Funny Faces. His process was simple. He drew some faces on a blackboard with chalk, photographed them, changed them slightly, photographed them again, and so on. When the film played, the faces appeared to come alive. In the film, the face of a woman blows smoke into the face of a man. Most film historians consider this to actually be the first animated cartoon. Winsor McCay knew James Stewart Blackton, and he almost certainly saw Blackton's film, although he never mentioned it. The next year, Blackton made another film, The Haunted Hotel. Best described as a trick film, it used stop-motion photography to make random household objects appear to move on their own, a teapot pouring itself, a knife floating across a room to cut a loaf of bread. The film eventually made its way to France, where it was seen by Émile Cole, a cartoonist who had once worked as a magician in Paris. After seeing Blackton's film, but before McKay would make Little Nemo, Cole decided that he also wanted to make animated cartoons. Émile Cole got upset whenever he heard someone give Winsor McCay credit for inventing animation. Muttering under his breath, his bushy mustache twitching, he would rush over to correct the offender. If the claim ever appeared in a newspaper, he'd quickly dash off a strongly worded letter to the editor. Such false claims often came from America, prompting Cole to joke that American ingenuity was just a euphemism for stealing other people's work. Throughout his career, Cole had problems with people stealing credit from him. But once, in 1907, it worked to his advantage. He was walking down a street in Paris when he spotted a poster for a movie that stole its concept from one of his comic strips. Cole figured that the film company, Gaumont, now probably owed him money, or at least some kind of credit. He stormed into the studio and demanded to speak with the person in charge. When he left, he had somehow managed to finagle a new career directing movies. It was a new industry then, and barriers to entry were low. Cinema intrigued Cole. This new art form had so many possibilities. He particularly admired film director Georges Méliès, whose films, The Vanishing Lady, The Cave of the Demons, and A Trip to the Moon, among others, were all known for their elaborate special effects and imaginative sequences. As a former magician, Cole no doubt wondered how Méliès had accomplished his visual effects. After seeing Blackton's The Haunted Hotel, he studied a copy of the film frame by frame, figuring out exactly how it worked. When Cole decided to make his first animated film in 1908, he was 51 years old and a veteran political cartoonist. He had much life experience. For his cartoon, he drew inspiration from his involvement in the Incoherence, a short-lived French art movement started by his friend Jules Lévy in 1882. Sporting a mustache resembling the wings of a condor in flight, Lévy was given to immodest pronouncements, per his era's fashion of avant-garde manifestos. When he announced his art movement, a predecessor of Dadaism, he declared that gaiety is properly French, so let's be French. To him, this meant the embrace of absurdist satire, dreams, and practical jokes. The Incoherence first exhibit, in 1883, was billed as an exhibition of drawings by people who do not know how to draw. It featured paintings like Negroes Fight in a Tunnel, which was nothing but a black canvas, and short films like A Cardinal Eating Lobster and Tomatoes by the Red Sea, which was nothing but a red screen. Cole wanted to give his first animated cartoon a sensibility similar to these exhibitions, insanity as its own aesthetic. Cole's animated film consisted of 700 separate drawings in India ink on white rice paper, traced and retraced over a light box. Although the film would be projected at a rate of 16 frames per second, Cole cut his work in half by making only 8 drawings for each second, then photographing each twice, helping to slow down the action and improve the fluidity of motion. When the film was developed, he asked that it be printed in negative to create a white-on-black effect. The final film was barely 2 minutes long and featured what were essentially stick figures. The action, however, was highly imaginative, calling to mind a stoned dream about the circus. The Incoherence would have been proud. The stick figures drift through an alternative dimension before becoming trapped in a bottle that suddenly transforms into a flower. Stepping out onto the stem of the flower, they soon found it turning into an elephant's trunk. Cole called his cartoon Fantasmagorie, borrowing the name from what lantern showman Étienne Gaspard Robert of Liège had presented to audiences in 1794. Fantasmagorie was shown in France, but didn't appear widely in the United States. Few Americans saw it, and none of America's early animators ever cited it as an inspiration. Instead, they typically referenced Winsor McCay's work, a habit that Cole would later haughtily point to as evidence of American provincialism. In 1912, 1 year after McCay premiered Little Nemo in Slumberland, Emile Cole moved to America to begin making movies, including animated cartoons. Stepping off the boat onto Ellis Island, he was promptly met by a customs agent who asked him to shave his mustache for sanitary reasons. Cole hesitated because his mustache, long and swoopy and twisted at the ends, had symbolic value. He had worn it for decades in honor of André Gide, a famous caricaturist who taught Cole the art of political cartooning. Gide had once used a cartoon to lampoon the incompetence of Napoleon III, an act that got him briefly thrown into jail, but also made him a legend among French cartoonists. Without the mustache, Cole resembled a plain-looking shopkeeper, or perhaps a jeweler, the kind of practical jobs his father had once pressured him to take before Gide taught him about cartooning. Cole shaved the mustache, but started growing it back immediately thereafter. Then he made his way to Fort Lee, New Jersey, where he started a job working for the American outpost of France's Eclair Studio. Before Hollywood became the undisputed capital of America's movie industry, many big studios were located in and around Fort Lee, New Jersey, just across the Hudson River from Manhattan. Almost all of Hollywood's first generation of moguls, Adolf Zukor of Paramount, Samuel Goldwyn of MGM, and William Fox of the Fox Film Corporation, among others, had grown up in New York. Fort Lee offered ample studio space and easy access to shooting locations. Because of the area's early role as a film center, it also became the center of the animation industry, which would linger there long after the live-action studios moved to California. One of Emile Cole's first assignments for Eclair was directing The Newlyweds, an animated series based on a popular American comic strip by George McManus, the cartoonist who first challenged Winsor McCay to make his animated cartoon Little Nemo in Slumberland. The studio wanted it as a regularly recurring series, and Cole did all the work himself. Because drawing the images by hand took a long time, he devised a shortcut using stop-motion photography and cutout figures similar to paper dolls. This was an enormous time saver, but resulted in a rudimentary appearance and jerky motion. In the end, the shoddy quality didn't particularly matter because theaters wanted the cartoons mainly for novelty effect, to play as a short amusement before their main features. Advertisements for Cole's cartoons brought to mind flyers for a magician's set. The Newlyweds are not real people dressed up to imitate the famous McManus cartoons, but are drawings that move, an Eclair poster read. Newspaper stories covering the new series mark the first time anyone used the term animated cartoons. None of the newspapers ever gave Cole credit. The name of George McManus as creator of the comic strip was far more marketable. Emile's name was recognizable in France, but rarely surfaced in American papers. When it did, it was often misspelled as E-M-I-L. In 1912, Cole saw Winsor McCay's second cartoon, The Story of a Mosquito, during a show at New York's Hammerstein Ballroom. In his diary, he raved about it. The cartoon was spooky, but also enchanting and fun, like the ideas the incoherents used to come up with. It featured a mosquito named Steve that occasionally descends on a sleeping man to drink his blood. Steve's abdomen filling like a water balloon before finally bursting. In many ways, it captured the same playful sense that Cole was going for, except that it was much more elaborate and better drawn. McCay had spent months producing the cartoon, and the result was gorgeous. Cole called him the most skillful and most graceful draftsman of the United States. In 1914, Cole saw Gertie the Dinosaur, McCay's third film, at the Hammerstein Ballroom. It was the kind of masterpiece that can change an artist's perspective. Nobody knew it yet, but Gertie is the film that would inspire many young cartoonists to try animation. Walt Disney spoke of his first time seeing Gertie the same way priests talk of finding God. The film was only a few minutes long, but had taken McCay nearly 2 years to make in his free time away from his day job drawing for the newspaper. Every part of Gertie was painstakingly precise. McCay had timed his breaths with a stopwatch in order to capture the motions of Gertie's heavy breathing. And no matter what Gertie was doing, throwing rocks at a mastodon, munching on trees, performing a dance number, her movements were perfect. The cartoon had little plot, but what made it significant was that Gertie showed personality, petulance, docility, humor, anger. Winsor had been able to capture these emotions with the subtlest of gestures, a crinkle around her eyes, a slight change to her smile. This was the film that would cement his reputation and make him the patron saint of animation. Ever the showman, McCay started showing Gertie as part of a vaudeville act. As the cartoon played, Winsor stood to the side of the stage and shouted commands at his character. He wore long coattails and cracked a bullwhip, like a lion tamer, playfully telling the crowd that Gertie was the only dinosaur in captivity. For a sequence featuring Gertie eating apples, McKay would toss real apples up and behind the screen. The show was clever and drew large, paying crowds, prompting Cole to later write, a bit huffily, "It was lucrative for McKay, who never left the theater without stopping by the cashier to be laden with a few banknotes on the way out." Emil Cole's frustration grew over the years. In the 1930s, long after he had moved back to France, reporters would occasionally visit but find him irritable. Sitting in his humble quarters, a dingy spare bedroom in his brother's house, the reporters would ask him about his political cartoons, but Cole would always change the topic to animation. He was annoyed that the French press called animation le mouvement américain, ignoring the contributions that the French, and by French he mainly meant himself, had also made. He told one reporter from Pourvue that the French didn't promote themselves as well as the Americans did, and this also bothered him. Poor promotional skills might be one reason Cole was forgotten, but another, much more likely reason, was that almost all the cartoons he animated in America were destroyed. A fire roared through the Eclair studios in Fort Lee a day after he set sail back to France in 1914. Film stock back then was highly flammable, much more so than today, and the studio flared up like a Roman candle. Only one of Cole's Newlyweds cartoons survived, and few other prints ever surfaced later. Nobody was thus able to see his legacy, which survived mainly by word of mouth. During his later years, Cole told another story of his time in America, this one verging on conspiracy. He said two strangers had visited him while he was living in New Jersey, one talkative, the other silent. They demanded to know how animated cartoons were made, but refused to reveal what they intended to do with the information. It remains unclear exactly what Cole told them. Perhaps not coincidentally, a similar visit was made to Winsor McCay around the same time, according to John Fitzsimmons, McKay's assistant during the time he made Gertie. He said that a man had showed up on McKay's doorstep, asking to learn his methods. McKay, eager to promote animation in the way that a missionary is eager to spread the word, gladly showed him. But this visitor had motives different from McKay's. The blossoming industry had attracted the attention of men who were more interested in profit than art. Chapter 3. The Artist's Dream. "Winsor, you've done it. You've created a new art," George McManus told Winsor McCay after seeing Gertie the Dinosaur. What McManus should have then added was, "Now go patent it." "Had I taken out patents, I would have strangled a new art in its infancy," McKay later explained. Animation's business potential didn't interest him as much as its artistic possibilities. It also helped that McKay wasn't particularly worried about money. He earned roughly $50,000 a year drawing for Hearst's newspaper, augmenting his salary with earnings from his vaudeville act. Others, however, were more intrigued by animation's commercial prospects. Among them was the man who darkened the doorway of McKay's studio seeking to learn his methods. John Randolph Bray was another newspaper cartoonist, but on the day of his visit, he posed as a reporter writing an article about animation. It was a disingenuous introduction designed to conceal his motives, but McKay never appeared to become suspicious. In fact, he was quite the opposite. Wishing to aid the writer in every way possible, according to John Fitzsimmons, McKay showed the young man every detail of the process he had developed. Bray then spent the next 18 months making his own cartoon, The Artist's Dream, a crowd-pleaser about a clever dog that reaches a plate of sausages on top of a dresser by using the drawers as steps, then eats so many sausages that he explodes. Simple but effective, Bray's cartoon was released in 1913, after which he immediately sold the rights to the French film company, Pathé, which had an office in Fort Lee, down the street from where Emile Cole worked at Eclair. Bray briefly worked for Pathé, and is likely one of the men who darkened Cole's doorway as well, although he never admitted it. "I was paid $2,000 for that first cartoon," Bray later remembered about the artist's dream. "Not much money to have earned in 18 months of terribly hard labor. But that didn't worry me, for I had worked out a process which made animated cartoons mechanically and commercially possible. I thought there was good money in it," he told an interviewer, explaining his motives. "But before animation could generate significant revenue, the processes behind it would need to be reimagined. What McKay had treated as an artisanal endeavor, slow and labor-intensive, Bray saw as a process that needed to become more efficient. He wanted to speed up production and make animated cartoons on a larger scale. America was at the beginning of a new age of mass media, led by cinema and radio, and Bray predicted that cartoons could be similarly lucrative if he could find a way to release them on a regular schedule. His second film, Colonel He's a Liar in Africa, a spoof of former President Teddy Roosevelt's globe-trotting exploits, was the first in a series meant to regularly appear in theaters, not as a one-off or as part of a vaudeville act, the way McKay had released his films. Shortly thereafter, Bray started Bray Productions. Working with an employee, Earl Hurd, he began testing new methods to make animation more efficient. One of the first problems the men addressed was how to combine moving characters with static backgrounds. McKay had simply ignored this problem, drawing everything, both moving and stationary parts, in every single frame, a redundant and time-consuming process. Bray's solution was to print multiple copies of the background and then draw his characters onto them, scraping away parts of the background that didn't need to be in the picture. This saved the animator from having to draw the entire background anew for each frame, so it was an enormous time saver. It also helped make the picture look more consistent, avoiding the little errors and vibrations introduced by constantly having to retrace stationary images. Within a year of this advance, Earl Hurd then pioneered the use of cells, transparent sheets on which moving parts of the action were drawn. These cells would be a mainstay of animation for decades to come. Placed over the backgrounds, which now needed to be printed only once, the clear sheets eliminated problems with screen flicker that had previously been caused by photographing the translucent tracing paper. Because they could be washed and reused, they also helped save money. Other new efficiencies used by Bray included the use of cycles, recycled drawings such as the leg movements in a stride that were used multiple times in the same cartoon. Together, these and other breakthroughs revolutionized the technical aspects of animation, increasing efficiency while lowering costs. Bray was bringing to animation the same mindset that Andrew Carnegie had brought to steelmaking, or that John D. Rockefeller had brought to oil production. Within a few years, animators would nickname him the Henry Ford of animation, a reputation he helped cultivate by appearing in magazine profiles dressed not as an eccentric artist, but as a shrewd mogul. A high collar riding halfway up his neck, every hair on his head nailed neatly into place. During interviews, he avoided speaking in the romantic style of Winsor McCay, and instead adopted the motivational style of language that captains of industry used to promote the American dream. "If you have faith in your dream and faith that you can make it a reality, don't be afraid to take a chance," he told one magazine. Bray modeled himself on moguls who didn't just change industries, but owned them, building great monopolies and crushing their competitors. He saw animation as a frontier where the land grab was only just starting. Soon he began patenting his processes, hoping to make a fortune by charging his competitors fees. Once his patents were registered, he then began suing. In 1914, Winsor McCay himself received in the mail a citation of infringement, claiming that he would be required to pay royalties on all future productions of animated cartoons to the holder of the patent rights. McCay was furious. He felt he was hijacked and double-crossed, according to his friend Isidore Klein, who would later become a cartoonist for The New Yorker. Bray responded carefully, never admitting that he had learned anything from McCay. "I didn't know Winsor McCay was doing anything," he told an interviewer in 1974 when he was 94 years old. "I just got the idea that I wanted to make animated cartoons for the movies. Winsor McCay never thought of that." Fortunately for McCay, Bray's original patent, filed in February 1914, was rejected by the patent examiner. He had seen McCay's Little Nemo in Slumberland and declared Bray's process too similar. Both used cross marks to register stationary drawings, both had an assistant trace the non-moving elements, and both had recycled drawings in order to use fewer of them. Bray's lawyer, Claire W. Fairbank, counter-argued that Bray's process was actually quite different. He highlighted Bray's various refinements, such as his method of printing multiple backgrounds, whereas McCay had simply retraced the background art for every frame. After 6 months of arguing, pressing his case, and wearing down the bureaucrats, Fairbank eventually got the patent granted, along with several more patents, including one for the use of cells. Now, with the paperwork settled and in place, Bray resumed his legal assault. What was perhaps most insulting to McCay was Bray's tone during their fight. Bray was condescending, sneering that McCay's cartoons were nothing more than an interesting curiosity exhibited and lectured about, as if they carried little more than academic value. Then he made a bold accusation, claiming that McCay's inefficient methods had caused the commercial failure of all attempts to secure animated cartoons prior to my invention. He was basically saying that animation was something he had to rescue from McCay, and McCay fumed over the misrepresentation. He certainly wasn't against Bray's genuine improvements. He actually encouraged them, since they promoted animation as an art form. What offended him was the prospect of having to pay Bray royalties, as well as Bray's insinuation that McCay was somehow degrading animation. Bray had even gone so far as to call his legal offensive a way to uphold the dignity of the animated cartoon. To McCay, this condescending language was a way to obscure Bray's true goal of establishing a monopoly. Bray was contributing useful new methods to animation, but wasn't necessarily using them for purposes that Winsor respected. Some of Bray's cartoons were clever, but others felt like novelties built around cheap gags made to get quick laughs. Bray valued quantity over quality. McCay avoided the lawsuit after his lawyers argued that Little Nemo in Slumberland was shown in theaters years before Bray filed for his patents. This protected him from further lawsuits, but didn't protect other animators. When McCay learned that Bray was planning to sue others, he didn't protest, but instead responded contradictory to his professed goal of championing animation for its own sake. He secretly worked out a deal whereby he would get a cut of any settlements. The arrangement was kept quiet. Historians wouldn't know about it for decades, until letters from Bray's attorney were discovered in McCay's private papers. Even so, McCay's cut would never amount to much. In 1932, the year Bray's patents ran out, it was a mere $65.71. McCay won a moral victory, but about 18 cents in cash, Isidore Klein joked. Bray would have a successful career in animation, but would never rule over the entire industry the way he once envisioned. Other competitors had carved out their own niches before he could establish dominance. One of them, Raoul Barré, had opened his own full-time studio in the Bronx in 1914, around the same time Bray opened his. Independent of Bray, Barre and his partner Bill Nolan had pioneered their own distinctive advancements, including a clever way to keep stacks of drawings in register by using pegs to hold them in place, thus helping animators trace their drawings more easily. They also began using special desks equipped with both this peg system and panes of glass that could be illuminated from below. Animation was quickly becoming a competitive field, full of new ideas. The new methods pioneered by men like Bray and Barre now allowed small crews of three or four animators to make a short cartoon in less than a month, compared with the 18 months it took Bray to make The Artist's Dream. Their upstart studios were able to release a regular stream of material to theaters, so long as they kept creating ideas. For his part, McKay continued down his own path, tackling ambitious material that he released only sporadically. Newcomers to the industry respected him for his artistry, but considered Bray's and Barre's model the best way to make a living. They knew that if animation were to survive and become more than a novelty, it would need to be profitable. The industry was still in its infancy, but beginning to attract more and more talent. Chapter 4. The Camera Fiend. One evening in 1914, Valdemar Kempfert, editor of Popular Science magazine, took his wife to the movies. Before the main feature started, one of John Bray's cartoons from the Colonel He's a Liar series flickered up on the screen. Kempfert's wife responded by slumping down in her seat and groaning, "Oh, how I hate these things." The next morning at work, Kempfert was complaining about how Bray's cartoon had almost ruined his date night with Mrs. Kempfert. Listening from the doorway was the magazine's young art editor, Max Fleischer. Kempfert explained that the cartoon's concept wasn't bad, but the execution was poor. The picture was wobbly and the movement jerky. He thought Fleischer might be able to do better. "Max, you're a bright young man," he said. "You're an artist, you understand mechanics and machinery and photography, and you've got a scientific mind. Surely you can come up with some idea, some way to make animated cartoons look better, smoother, and more lifelike." Fleischer came from a long family line of people who enjoyed tackling such challenges. His father, a tailor by trade, was a constant tinkerer who had invented the detachable-faced brass buttons that allowed police officers to shine them without smudging their uniforms with polish. His brother Joe had built a wireless radio that allowed him to hear about the Titanic sinking before it was in the news. And his brother Charlie had invented the penny arcade claw digger machine. Max, likewise, understood machines and instruments, loved touching them, loved the smell and language of workshops and labs. At 31 years old, he had spent the previous decade working in one form or another on all the different aspects that composed animation: drawing, photography, mechanics. In a previous stint as a cartoonist at the Brooklyn Daily Eagle, he had even created a comic strip, E.K. Sposure, The Camera Fiend, specifically about photography. Now, animation offered Fleischer a chance to combine his two great loves, art and engineering. "To me, machinery was an art also," he would later write. "I still see great art in machinery." Fleischer took up Kempfert's challenge by designing a machine consisting of a projector and a glass drawing board with a camera dangling above it. The idea was to film an action scene, a person dancing, for example, and then project the images onto the glass drawing board, where a person could then trace them. The timing of the camera would hopefully help smooth the motion. He called his device a rotoscope. Fleischer's younger brother Dave was excited when he heard about the idea. Both had seen Winsor McCay's Gertie the Dinosaur earlier that year and left the theater enchanted. The film inspired Dave to begin taking whatever paper was at hand, notebooks, phone books, etc., and create flipbooks. His favorite subjects were scenes to accompany popular songs of the day, creating a kind of precursor to music videos. Earlier that year, Dave had taken a film editing job for Pathé in Fort Lee, in the hope of starting a career in film. Dave was fascinated by it, Max recalled about his rotoscope idea. He couldn't sleep anymore. The brothers got to work building their rotoscope, enlisting the help of the three other Fleischer brothers, Charlie, Joe, and Lou. Because of their day jobs, they worked in Max's living room until the small hours of the morning, often around 4 o'clock, trying not to wake Max's wife, Essie, sleeping in the next room. Essie, a 5'3" firecracker with a constantly smoking short fuse and a slightly broken nose that was never properly set, as her son Richard would later describe her, had a vicious temper that Max and his brothers didn't want to upset. But besides her temper, she was otherwise supportive. When Max told her he had spent all their savings, about $100, on his rotoscope idea, she didn't blow up as the brothers expected. Instead, she went off to the bedroom and came back with $150 she had saved on her own. She had a heavy gambling habit and was currently in the black. Handing the money over to Max, she told him, "This is for your crazy idea." Once the rotoscope was finished, Max Fleischer got hold of a Charlie Chaplin film. The brothers spent 8 months tracing every move of the star's jaunty waddle, feeling their way through the process, not always fully aware of other animators' advancements. It was a learning time for all. Again, they worked in Max's living room late into the night, bleary-eyed when the morning sun peeked through the curtains. Once they finished rotoscoping and tracing, the final cartoon was 3 minutes long. The brothers were pleased with the result. Fleischer tried showing the cartoon to film distributors, but could get meetings with only two. Once the first one saw it, he looked at Max and asked, "That's very nice. What are you going to do with it?" "I don't know," Fleischer answered. "I just thought it was something, that's all." "Could you make one of these a week?" Fleischer laughed at the question. This had taken him nearly a year. He could probably do it faster the second time, but not much faster. "My dear fellow," the distributor advised, "go home and make something practical. If you had something we could offer for sale every week or every month, you'd have something." Fleischer's second appointment was with J.A. Burst, an executive at Pathé who admired the quality of the brothers' animation but didn't want to buy it. What if Chaplin sued? Fleischer was crestfallen, berating himself for not thinking of the legal angle. But Burst was encouraging nonetheless. He invited Fleischer to return once he had something original. After Max shared this news with Dave, Dave came up with an idea. Max and Dave Fleischer were a good pairing, but not without their differences. Max dressed impeccably, his suits neatly tailored and his Chaplin-esque dab of a mustache always precisely manicured. Dave was sloppier. His hair wild and his shirt tails sometimes untucked, he had only a nodding acquaintance with decorum. Max's courtship with Essie was relatively formal, while Dave had proposed to his wife, Ida Charnow, on Halloween night by handing her a bag of candy with a ring at the bottom. When Max presented the challenge of creating an original character, Dave recalled his days working as a clown on the Coney Island boardwalk. This was when Coney Island was a rough place of con men and pickpockets, of lipstick-smeared prostitutes calling down to men from the fire escapes. Dave's job didn't necessarily involve normal clown activities, such as making balloon animals, so much as it meant playing questionable pranks on people. One favorite prank involved shocking unsuspecting passersby with a weakly charged electric whip. "They'd scream every time, and they'd run like hell, and that was my job," Dave later recalled. Sometimes he'd use the whip to scare women into jumping over holes that had fans strategically hidden under them, then watch as gusts of air blew the ladies' dresses up. As soon as Max told him his problem of needing an original character, Dave dragged his old clown suit out of the closet. The simple design, a baggy suit with three side buttons and a pointy hat, all in clean black and white, would show up well on film and be easy to animate. The other Fleischer brothers were again enlisted to help make a cartoon of the new character. They climbed up to Max's roof, rigged up a white sheet as a background, and filmed a minute's worth of Dave dancing around in the suit. Then they spent roughly a month tracing the images using the rotoscope, followed by 5 months of inking and photographing the separate images. J.A. Burst at Pathé was pleased when he saw the final cartoon. He immediately agreed to give them space in his Fort Lee studio, as well as build them 3 more rotoscopes. The brothers were excited, but within a few days, Burst voiced second thoughts. Like many others, he wasn't convinced that animated cartoons would ever be more than just a novelty. Growing increasingly skeptical, he pressed Max to explain how his cartoons would fit in with the studio's newsreels, comedies, and serials. Fleischer tried to reassure him by pitching an idea he thought was a surefire success. Instead of featuring a clown, they would instead feature Teddy Roosevelt, much as John Bray had done with his Colonel He's a Liar series. Fleischer's version, however, had a twist. He wanted to add the plot from Chanticleer and the Fox, a story from Geoffrey Chaucer's Canterbury Tales about a proud rooster who believed the sun rose and set based on his crowing. After hearing the pitch, Burst agreed. Dave sat dumbfounded when Max later explained everything to him. What was wrong with the clown? Max's plan to involve a Chaucer story illuminated a difference between the brothers' sensibilities. Max sometimes wanted to go highbrow when Dave wanted to keep their material simple. Nor did Dave see how the Canterbury Tales angle connected with Teddy Roosevelt and the Colonel He's a Liar series. It seemed disjointed. But Max persisted, telling Dave that he had already discussed it with Burst and that Burst was comfortable with doing a political satire. Besides, Max continued, adding the rooster storyline might be a good way to flatter studio owner Charles Pathé, who had adopted a rooster as the studio's mascot.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.